final presentation for Hacking for Defense, our first inaugural course here at UC San Diego's Jacobs School of Engineering. We have a couple guests online with us right now. They'll be coming on to speak here in just a second. Dr. Ray Bittner from Naval Postgraduate School, and then Saad Azari from the Office of the Undersecretary of the Navy. So I'll pass it over to them in just a second. But first, just a bit about Hacking for Defense.
A touch of feedback, I'm gonna make sure I'm muted.
All right, so just a bit about Hacking for Defense, and I know many of you are familiar somewhat, or maybe a little bit, or maybe very in some cases, and we've got people that have traveled in, and we've got people here from the school itself. We've got the students sitting up front here, people interested in from all angles, and then we've got a video camera in the back, so this will be preserved for generations for us to see, no pressure. So Hacking for Defense is a collaboration between military and federal government and academia. And it's an opportunity for students within the school to work on some of the military and federal government's hardest problems. And so what we've done in this case is worked with the Office of the Undersecretary of the Navy, brought a couple of problems to the table around humanitarian operations and then around defense against swarms. Things that they're big problems that they're looking for into the future. Dropped those on the students' plate, gave them 6 weeks and said, go, let's see what you can give us. And they did absolutely remarkable job. And so you'll be able to see that here in a second. You'll see the results of what they've done. And you'll also hear quite a bit about their journey going through it as well, because we think that's just as important as anything else. And by no means are they finished now. They're anxious and ready to keep going with it, and we find that inspiring as well. So let's see if we can get Saad Ansari, again, Office of the Undersecretary of the Navy. He's calling in from D.C. Saad, let's get you up on the screen and then get you on audio, and here's your chance.
One second. Can you hear me? Okay, can you talk?
Yes, can you hear me right now?
Yeah.
There he is.
Hey, everybody.
Hi.
So everybody can hear me, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. Well, first of all, thank you for coming out tonight, and thank you for participating in the course. Thank you, Ellen and Travis, for teaching it. Thank you, Dr. Bittner, for helping PAs and get the students the resources they needed. Thank you, Team Coco. Please forgive me if I pronounce anybody's name wrong. Ethan, Jason, May, and Hui?
Hui.
And also, thank you, Team Seek, Swarm, and Destroy. Also, extra points for creative naming. Although the Coco is pretty creative, too. Andy, Raina, Samantha, and Richard. I just got your PowerPoints a few minutes ago, so I haven't had time to go through those yet. But I did go through the preliminaries, and those look very promising. And I also appreciated, as a former data scientist, I appreciated your use of visuals. And so I just wanted to say something really, a few things really briefly, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Bittner, who was very engaged with your projects. And so the first thing I wanted to say was thank you. The second thing is that I know learning about Navy is very difficult. So I've been in the Office of the Undersecretary of the Navy for just a few months, but before then I was also involved with the previous Undersecretary of the Navy, the acting Undersecretary, and before that I was in OSD policy. But even up to today, like we are learning new and remarkable things about how the organization works. For instance, just today we took the Undersecretary to Naval Research Laboratory, which you should look into. It's a great institution. They have some great scientists there. And I found out that in this building right across from the Pentagon, right across the river, they have the world's biggest standing stop motion capture room in the world. So I was like, could you film Lord of the Rings in this room? And they were like, yes, we could. And so you discover something new about the Navy every single day. The biggest stop capture, stop motion, I didn't know what it was called, stop motion capture, or is it stop capture motion room in the world? And you know, there we also kind of saw some technologies which are useful to the things that you are looking at. For example, on robotic humanitarian affairs, they have this one robot. It's a land unmanned vehicle, which also launches an aerial unmanned vehicle, and they kind of travel as a pair, where you deploy one on land and the other one goes and kind of does, it can do search and rescue ISR operations on air. So these are things we're actually working on. And I knew that we had that particular capability, but I didn't know how far it would kind of go along. So you learn a lot of really interesting things every single day. This is from somebody who's been kind of doing that for months. Dr. Bittner's been doing it for years. You all have been doing it for weeks. And so You all have come a very long way given the short amount of time you've had. Now, the main kind of substantive piece I wanted to say is explain kind of where your products will fit into the Undersecretary's goals. So this Undersecretary of the Navy was commissioned by Congress, the Senate Armed Services Committee, to look at our naval architecture. Naval architecture is kind of what it sounds like. How are our ships and our forces, including the Marines, architected, structured in a system of systems to be able to deliver their mission? The goal was to figure out what is the value of unmanned systems in naval architecture. You can articulate things about individual unmanned platforms. This can fly faster, this aggregated, this is, you know, XYZ. But it's hard to articulate the value in the context of the $170 billion per year of investment we already make. So that was the point, more or less, of the warming. What is the value of unmanned systems in naval architecture? We had four teams, and unlike other war games, the point of this event, and Dr. Bittner might say about this too, it was not to analyze, to figure out facts about individual systems, but it was to synthesize across the entire Department of the Navy. And we're a huge organization. Like I said, over the next 30 years, we spend $5.5 trillion. We have hundreds of thousands of people working for us. We have aircraft carriers, which are the most expensive thing outside of the International Space Station that humans have built. So it's a lot to manage. And I want to read this quote to you, because I thought maybe, you know, you as students would appreciate this. When thinking about synthesizing between various ideas, including your own ideas, we will try to incorporate what you came up with in our outreach report of that event, from which the point was to figure out, the value of unmanned and naval architecture, and come up with new value statements. And I'll try to get into a little bit of those, and I'll finish after that. But I took a little bit of inspiration from Buckminster Fuller. Is anybody familiar with who Buckminster Fuller is?
Sure.
Yeah.
You know, the geodesic dome guy. Also happens to be, he also happens to be a Navy sailor. But he had this quote, and I thought it was pretty cool. We are in an age that assumes that the narrowing trends of specialization to be logical, natural, and desirable. In the meantime, humanity has been deprived of comprehensive understanding. Specialization has bred feelings of isolation, futility, and confusion in individuals. It has also resulted in the individuals leaving responsibility for thinking and social action to others. Specialization breeds biases that ultimately aggregate as international and ideological discord, which in turn leads to war. Now, that might sound really crazy and over the top to you all, but when you're in the Pentagon for a few months, you start feeling that, whoa, this is totally true. And so the point was to get people to be uncomfortable, think out of the box, provide help with new ideas. There were four groups, and I think all did a pretty good job. One group, they basically talked about how unmanned could unlock forward presence, so being present such that if a humanitarian disaster happened, we are disaggregated and forward in, you know, our presence, is what it sounds like, in ships, such that we can respond very quickly. And being able to respond to a lot of what's called phase zero, pre-war situations, requires the human touch, right? Like, you have to have people go and talk to people in a humanitarian situation or in stability operations. And so what unmanned systems could do is take care of logistics and intelligence and all those sort of things, so humans can do what humans have to do. We had another group that talked about the unique capabilities unmanned technology brings to various, you know, naval operations. We had another group talk about how unmanned technologies enable logistics for distributed operating concepts. And maybe some of what I'm saying sounds all jargony. It's not super relevant to your groups. If you have any questions, you can let me know. And a third group, the last group, it was actually a pretty sophisticated analysis. They kind of broke down a game-by-game play on how unmanned systems could fit into phase, what's called phase zero, phase two, or phase three naval operations. So it was all the way up to the beginning of conflict, particularly once again on kind of intelligence and logistics and that sort of thing. So it was very fruitful, and based on your preliminary reports, I can already see how that will fit in. What I'm going to do is I will socialize your reports with all the participants. I'll send it out by email. I'm going to be asking all of them for feedback in general to the write-up of the war game, and we'll kind of synthesize and have that as an overview. But I will stop talking because Dr. I'm sure has more in-depth things to say. I wanted to ask, does anybody have any questions based on anything I said?
Nope.
Okay, cool. And I just wanted to thank you, and I wanted to encourage you all, with no matter what you do in your careers, whether you're going to technology in the private sector, whether you want to come into government, do think about how to be involved in public service. There's many ways. And don't just contribute your technology, but contribute your vision for national security as well. And what you think this country, how this country should be going to, because oftentimes, you folks think differently. And that's what we need, not just in our technology, but also in how we structure our organizations. Thank you. Thank you for everything you've done.
Thank you, Saad. Dr. Bittner, are you still on the line? Can you switch over your screen?
He talks and he switches.
Yeah. And he's on mute.
Dr. Bittner, I think you're on mute.
Dr. Bittner, can you hear us? Is he frozen? Oh, no. Yep, I guess so. All right, Saad, if you have a minute or two more, I suppose you could say a word or two in Dr. Bittner's place. Dr. Bittner, are you back?
I think I'm back.
All right, you're back. Wonderful. We've got you on the screen now. We can hear you on audio. Welcome. And again, for those in the audience, Dr. Bittner is with the Naval Postgraduate School. There's a tremendous amount of expertise in this particular areas that the students have been looking for the projects. And the really interesting facet of where he sits is that he gets to look closely into what the military is doing, particularly in the Navy, and then he also gets close, has a very good understanding of how the academic and research process goes as well. So he sits at the nexus of that and was able to help tap the students into those resources. So without further ado, Dr. Bittner.
Okay, I'll keep it relatively short. There's not a lot to add to what Saad has told you. I will give you a couple caveats. One is, you may have a wonderful idea and we may not be able to tell you about it and you may never know where it goes. And it's happened a couple of times in my career that I've championed an idea, moved it, it seemed to go away and nothing more happened. And then literally a couple of years later, I found out not only did something happen, but there's an entire program based around that work. In some sense, that is one of the, that would be a big win for us. If you guys have come up with something that's so super and so great that we not only want to use it, but we don't want anyone else to use it. So realize that. We can't always tell you exactly how we would use what you've taught us as we go forward. And to second Saad, I'd like to thank you very much for helping the other 1%, those of us that wear uniforms in defense of the nation, those folks out there, men and women, are roughly 1% of the population. And the work that you're doing and you're thinking and learning about them and their problem sets and thinking about how a business model could be developed to support that is really useful. And then in light of your current challenges, both trying to move material through the Straits of Hormuz as you set up your scenario, and then in humanitarian assistance disaster relief, I'll let you know that all around the world today, the U.S. Marine Corps is celebrating its birthday. So they actually, Travis, were you a Marine pilot or?
Still a Marine, was a pilot, that's right.
There you go, so a Marine. So maybe Travis somewhere has had some cake and listened to the Commandant's speech. I'm actually out calling in from Paso Robles, California, where we're doing field experiments today, including using small UAVs built out of cardboard with laser cutters that DARPA has funded as a project, looking at how we would do things like deliver goods in a humanitarian assistance environment without creating the environmental things that go along with littering an area with large numbers of composite materials, plastic, and metal. So your work is really in the sweet spot. Both of these programs are very relevant, and I'm very excited to hear what you guys have to say about them. And I can't actually see any of you at the moment, so I will be quiet and let you move forward unless there's any questions for me before we begin.
Any questions? So there's no questions.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Bittner. Appreciate your time.
You're welcome.
All right. So next up, we'd like, before we kick off the student presentations, we'd like to share just a bit more about the program, what we've done to bring it here, and where we're planning to head with the program in the future. So next up, I would like to bring Mike Krupp. Mike has been instrumental in helping us dig in and get this going. I met Mike early on setting this up, and Mike from the Von Liebig Center for Entrepreneurship here at UC San Diego.
Great, thanks. Well, first off, I'm speaking on behalf of what was originally an initiative of Dean Pisano, who got very excited when he first heard about Hacking for Defense, and he's basically gave us the charge, go do it. And I think that's about all he told us, just go do it. And so the good news is we have a great team, staff at Von Liebig, tremendous support from Deneen Hagen, who is the assistant dean for new initiatives and other programs. And we have been able to do something which I think is pretty amazing. We brought off a six-week mini course on doing something totally new. And at the same time, I think we've been able to really get at some of the goals that the dean has for, I think, engineering education and entrepreneurship at Jacobs School. The dean's very much interested in about three things, in my opinion, and I'm going to say that I think Hacking for Defense touches on a lot of them. One is the dean believes very much that people should, who are being trained as engineers, should learn how to address real-world problems and solve them. And Hacking for Defense meets that in every way. Real-world problems that are very important, very difficult, that require a lot of creative thinking and really test what skills are being learned in the engineering school. And I think we're really excited about this first pilot and look forward to making this a big program going forward. The second thing I think that is very important is that we have a very large community in San Diego of defense contractors and the military. And the idea is to build a more close working relationship with that community on Jacobs School, to be able to leverage what they have and what we have to solve really significant problems. And I think, again, as we go forward, we're going to be looking at a variety of problems, all the way from cyber to advanced, you know, vehicles, as we're doing now with UAVs, and a variety of other exciting problems. And so I think that, again, meets. And then I think the third thing is really this whole idea of getting people to work to solve problems in teams. And Hacking for Defense requires teams, and that's what we're doing. So I think this is something that not only adds to what our offerings are currently, but really brings a whole new dimension to the kinds of programs that we have. What I'd like to say is where this is going to fit inside the Jacobs School briefly is we now have created a new institute called the Institute for the Global Entrepreneur. We have a variety of programs, including NSFI Corps. We have educational programs. Hacking for Defense fits squarely in the middle of that initiative, and it's going to become a key part of that initiative. And we are very excited about, as that institute grows and Hacking for Defense grows, we think it's going to be a pretty powerful combination. And with that, I'll give you the stars of the show.
Great. Thank you, Mike.
Sure.
And then finally, before we kick off, I'd like to introduce you to my colleague, co-instructor for the course, Ellen Chang. First of all, on a personal level, my gratitude for putting in so much work into the course and making it really what it's become. But also, Ellen brings a number of things to the table that really were key in helping this happen. Her connections here within both the military community as a naval reservist, within the military acquisitions community as a former employee of Northrop Grumman who's left the dark side to now dive into entrepreneurship. Ellen works with a number of local startups in the aerospace, defense, new space, drone startup space. And so bringing all those forces to bear and then bringing those in the classroom, that wealth of knowledge has been a tremendous asset for the students and the school and hacking for defense more broadly. So with that, I'll give the floor to Ellen before the students' teams come up, and she's going to share a bit about how we ran the course and what it's all about.
Thanks, Travis. Yeah. Travis is no slacker himself. Lots of background there, too. So let me just give you an overview of the class. This one was just 6 weeks, and I think we accomplished a tremendous amount. As Mike said, a lot of teamwork. But the framework is based on the Lean Startup methodology, where you have a business model canvas. But in this case, instead of a business model canvas, you have a mission model canvas that has been slightly adapted, similar principles, in order to understand development for maybe a government type of environment. And you'll see the mission model canvases of the two teams today. Another key element of the course is customer discovery, i.e. getting outside of the classroom and talking to people. So we have a lot of engineering students who got a lot of training and a lot of experience in 6 weeks on talking to people that you don't know, how you frame your problem, how do you do research in order to provide a foundation from which to have a discussion with people outside of your own domain. So that was key. And then finally, we envelope the teams, not just with instructors, but also experts. So I'd like to recognize Vinny and Bob and Justin to stand up, please. I mean, these are folks who have been in the Navy, worked with the Navy, and currently in working on acquisitions, and so they have supported the team the whole time, and it's been a tremendous. We still have a few others that couldn't make it tonight, Andy von Stauffenberg, and we have Dan Hendricks, who wasn't able to make it. So with that, I painted kind of a picture of the course. I think what you'll see from the student presentations, the culmination, they'll talk about what they week one to week six, as well as their emotional journey. With that, let me invite Team Coco up to the stage. They're going to present first. I think your slides are up. And you take it away.
Thank you. Thank you. And the mics.
Make sure to speak up so everybody can hear.
Hello? Hello?
Okay, and then there's one too.
Mic check. Mike.
Thank you, Ellen. First of all, I just want to say thank you. Good evening, and thank you for joining us here tonight. We are Team Coco, and we were part of one of two teams that got invited to participate in the Hacking for Defense pilot course at UC San Diego. So as Ellen mentioned, Hacking for Defense is a class that gives students the opportunity to solve problems sponsored by DoD and intelligence communities that addresses the nation's emerging threats and security challenges. So our team specifically focused on the use of robotic vehicles and autonomous systems in humanitarian operations. And so my name is Hui, I'm a third year aerospace engineering major.
My name is Ethan, I'm a third year mechanical engineering major.
Good evening everyone, I'm May, and I'm a third year electrical engineering major.
And my name is Jason, third year computer science major.
And we could not have done this without the tremendous help and support of our instructor and mentors, Ellen, and Mr. Dan Hendricks, who unfortunately could not make it here today, and military liaison, Dr. Ray Butner from the Naval Postgraduate School, and the prom sponsor, Mr. Saad Ansari, from the Office of the Undersecretary of the Navy. So a couple of weeks ago, Italy was devastated by a 6.6 magnitude earthquake, and we thought this could be a real-life situation where our system could potentially deploy and help coordinate all the various agency and first responders that show up at the scene. As we found out during the 6 weeks, the three biggest challenges with humanitarian operations and disaster relief are communications, coordination, and cooperation. So Ethan will brief you on our problem statement evolution.
So our problem statement here, so just a general overview, each week we came up with a problem statement, and this was to figure out what we're trying to address. As we figured out, we can't just go right ahead and go building a product without having anyone to address it to, because that's pretty useless. So as we figured out, so we did quite a bit of searching. So week zero, we initially thought that we were going to be doing something along the lines of just initial response, like the first 72 hours after disaster has happened, we'd be working with the firefighters, military branches, anyone who's there, say if it's like Hurricane Matthew or something that happens in Florida, We would be on site or focusing on deploying an unmanned vehicle on site to aid with the actual deployment of supplies, first aid kits, delivery of medical supplies, stuff like that. And as we progressed in the weeks, we kind of figured out that maybe we're going to focus more on the three C's: cooperation, coordination, and communication between groups. So if you're in a disaster area, you're going to have several groups coming in and trying to all act at once. And as we figured out, this might be problematic. So our goal here, we figured maybe was that the Navy needs a supervisory management system that's capable of overlaying inputs on a geographical layout. And this would be under input of a large scale type map. So this would help aid with coordination, communication, and cooperation between all groups.
So in the process of these past 6 weeks, part of what we had to do, as Ellen mentioned, in a main part of our class is the Mission Model Canvas. And due to for the Mission Model Canvas, we had to determine beneficiaries and also the value proposition for each beneficiary that we determined. And we've, over the past 6 weeks, we've had to talk to at least 50 people, 50 stakeholders, and just to give you a brief picture of the people we've talked to people from the Navy, from the Air Force, helo pilots, people who've had experience with drones, so experts in that area, and a lot of other people.
All right, so this is our emotional adventure throughout the 6 weeks of our pilot course. As you can see, initially, we were 100%, and we believe that everything was going to be smooth sailing, and we're going to figure it out. But then, as you can see, that steeply dropped, and then we realized that a lot of our ideas were inapplicable. And through many interviews, they weren't addressing the specific problems that they were having. So initially, we thought about using a Bluetooth system to track individuals that are stuck during natural disasters such as hurricanes, etc. And then we switched back into a supervisory system that aimed to create a managerial interface of U.S. naval assets. And then as we progressed, we thought about further options we could add on, such as machine learning and image detection, and even crowdsourcing, where we could collect data from individuals who were in the area of interest and needed help.
So just an introduction again to our stakeholders, our main stakeholders. These are just three of our main stakeholders. And these include the local emergency first responders and also the host nation's government, but most importantly, our most important stakeholder are external agencies, and these include the USAID and donor nations. And Ethan will expand on.
So just to get a sense of how a humanitarian operation works, so you would think that maybe initially something happens, the US Navy's right there and ready to go respond. But that's not quite the case. So as we found out, so say a disaster is struck, so the host nation figures out and assesses the damage that has happened and figures out, can they handle this on their own? If not, they have to send a request to the U.S. Embassy, who then forwards this request to the Department of State, then this goes down the line to the Department of Defense, and down the line to the USAID or the combatant commander in the region, whoever happens to be there. And this combatant commander can choose to send a joint task force down, have them go down and just to assist in the relief efforts on hand.
Okay, so here's our beneficiary evolution. So initially, we were looking for beneficiaries that our mission, our product would add value to. And then initially, we thought that it would be the U.S. Navy as a whole, but we soon realized that that was way too broad, and that didn't provide value to anyone specific. So then we switched into local first responders, but then we soon crossed that out because they were inaccurate depictions of how humanitarian operations would occur out of the U.S. So we switched into providing value to the mission commanders such that our interface would provide a common operating picture to the mission commander and see, allow him to make decisions based on the information depicted on the interface. And then it would also improve communication with NGOs and other organizations that might be operating in the same area. So yeah, we believe that these two organizations would receive main value from Aurora.
So during the past 6 weeks, we've had to come up with a minimum viable product every week. And through the process, of course, this has changed multiple times. Sometimes we've had to make a complete turn and rethink about everything. But this is what we have at the end of our 6 weeks. So mainly what we have is an informational system that aims to integrate user input and also integrate that with data from sensing technologies that will detect and track drones.
Right, so the underlying model of our product would be first identify the UAV through some sort of image detection and recognition system, and then try to categorize the UAV, whether it be enemy, foe, commercial drones, from NGOs, etc., and display the geolocation and other data collected from that drone on an interface so that the mission commander would be able to see and make decisions based on that information.
On screen here is our mission model canvas. So as Ellen mentioned, the mission model canvas is a business model created by SteepLink and has been adapted for mission-driven purposes. The mission model canvas plays is one of three integral parts in the Lean Startup methodology. So the mission model canvas allows the team, us, to quickly frame our hypotheses and test our and put out, plan everything out and our initial assumptions and everything on one single screen so we can see and track our progresses. So the next step in the Lean Startup methodology is customer discovery. Each week we're tasked with getting out the building and discovering our beneficiaries, stakeholders, and various investors and partners in humanitarian assistance and disaster relief operations. So as May mentioned, we talked to people from Defense Department, the Navy, the Air Force, and during those conversations, we were able to test our hypotheses and validate our findings. And the last part of the Lean Startup methodology is agile engineering. The team builds the MVP in the previous slides to maximize the learning outcomes. And as the week progresses, hopefully the MVP will address the needs better for the customers. So on screen, I want to focus on two important boxes, the value proposition and the beneficiaries. So the value proposition is what our system will bring to the customer or the beneficiaries. So in this case, the MVP would allow for better management of the ship's resources, specifically unmanned vehicles. And this will allow for optimized response and minimize risks. So our first beneficiary is the mission commander, or the Joint Task Force commander. From our geographical display, the commander will have a higher assurance of safety, and he or she could potentially see conflicting areas and unsafe areas on the geographical display. Our second beneficiaries are the naval operators, or pilot of manned aircraft, specifically helos and fighter jets at low altitude. So given the system, the pilots could be well aware of his or her airspace safety and knowledge of operators such as civilians or NGOs flying drones delivering supplies in the area. And lastly, the dual use. We found out that the system could not only benefit navies and military customers, but also NGOs consumers. So NGOs are non-governmental organizations such as Red Cross and Doctors Without Borders, who utilizes commercially available off-the-shelf drones to deliver packages such as medical supply and aid to affected population after a disaster has struck. So with our system, they could potentially input their flight plan and get specific approval from an mission commander to allow for maximum utilization of the airspace. And I'll hand it off to Ethan to talk about some real-life example and future timeline.
So a real-life example of where this could come into play is there was a fire, I think, about a year ago. And in the area, they were trying to get tanker planes mobilized. But unfortunately, they could not because there were people. Someone called in that there were people flying drones in the area, and they couldn't do anything about it. So a system like this could potentially allow for people to input where they're going to fly their drones ahead of time and put this on screen to reassure airspace confidence. For the future here, after we talked to quite a few people during the last few weeks, so we kind of wrapped this up, and we figured out that eventually maybe we'd do something along the lines of developing an informational command and control system capable of integrating crowdsourced data through aggregation tools. This could potentially help out organizations like CAL FIRE or people who are trying to do air traffic control. Another option that we looked into could have been not fully autonomous, but just using like artificial type intelligence to be able to gauge intent or to gauge friend or foe of assets on the battlefield. Something else that this could assist with could be potential for decision making. So if you have AI that could be gauging and making decisions based off of data that is collected, such as how many people need resources, what kinds of people are in the area, who's there. Our goal for this would be to enhance surveillance and reconning techniques. So potentially, to get this all rolled out and deployed, we would need to integrate this seamlessly with the Navy's infrastructure, because otherwise we would need to, otherwise we would not be able to effectively get people the services that they need. And just for our future iteration here, the next, like version 2.0 perhaps, would probably be something more involved with crowdsourcing, because as we found, there's kind of a big gap in between with what the Navy has and what civilian intel has. So if there's a way that we can get civilian intel across, then we could possibly bridge the problem of not enough data or too much data. So if these civilians can help pinpoint certain things and just get the Navy on time, this could potentially increase the potential for better deployment of services and better mission awareness. So this is our lessons learned slide, and throughout these past 6 weeks, we learned a lot. We learned how to frame hypotheses, challenge our assumptions, and getting after voting. We learned the inside and outs of how Department of Defense and intelligence communities work, and we learned how to challenge our own assumptions and think outside the box. So during week zero, our team originally had the idea of going down the path using object detection and machine learning algorithms to identify friends, foes, and gauging intent. But as we found out during the very first couple interviews with professors from the Jacobs School of Engineering, gauging intent is a very tricky subject. For example, it's hard enough for a human to gauge another human's action and intent based on verbal cues and the body language. It's near impossible for robots and unmanned systems to do that from the air or in the water. So we left that hornet's nest alone. So a couple weeks later, we talked to Dr. Linton Wells, and he has mentioned that crowdsourcing is the future. And as Ethan mentioned, crowdsourcing utilizes volunteers and civilians just like you and me to sort through data and potentially create metadata. So data about data. That this could potentially be incorporated into a common operational picture that a Navy commander could use and potentially make effective decision off of. So in summary, the Navy is still figuring out how to use UAVs to their full potential and incorporate them to humanitarian assistance and disaster relief operations. There is still a lack of a means for streamlining both civilian data and intelligence data from the Navy and other branches because compartmentalization and different security clearance level.
So I actually want to take back something that we said. He said that it's near impossible, and I don't want to say that because we don't know how big the capabilities of autonomous vehicles are, and that could possibly be in the future. But as of right now, we know that it's still in the early stages of incorporating these drones and unmanned vehicles into HADR missions. And so we learned that there's many ways that they could be integrated into these missions. So there's, we use them as defense kind of like a defense thing where they could be protecting forces while they're out doing their missions, protecting them from looters or whatever danger is in the area. But they could also be used to help, to aid, like how Doctors Without Borders, they utilize drones to send medical aid, food, and supplies to people who needed it. So we just found that there's a lot of ways to incorporate drones into HADR missions.
All right, so our presentation comes to an end. So throughout the 6 weeks, we have many people to thank. Their expertise and their information about current naval technology and working systems. We want to give thanks to members of the MPS, SPAWAR, military stakeholders, commercial drone experts and our instructors, specifically Ellen Chang and Travis Meister. And thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Yeah, we have time for a few questions. Does anybody have any questions? They want to drill at Team Coco? Sir?
It looked like you heavily relied on a lot of interviews, which is commendable and also can yield some interesting results that you didn't expect. Was there any effort to get, for example, the Red Cross has been doing this for years. They probably have a stack of procedure manuals. Says, here's what we do in an earthquake disaster. Here's what we do in flooding, and I'm sure some of the other organizations, maybe you can't get the other governments to give you the documents, but Doctors Without Borders would be another one. Did you make any effort or to get those kind of manuals, or do you think there was too much resistance to share it?
Do you talk to
me? We talked to a business operation manager at Red Cross, and he said that, yes, Red Cross focused on providing temporary shelter in terms of a big disaster. But they have been moving away from their traditional model, which is like providing shelter and food and resources. But they're more towards providing cash and temporary relief aid, such as money and those sort of stuff.
With a follow-up to that, isn't there a big difference between a foreign country with a disaster and a disaster in this country in terms of that approach?
Yes, definitely. Mm-hmm.
Question in the back.
I'm wondering, what did you learn from all those interviews? How do you feel about doing 50 interviews, and how was it from the beginning compared to the end?
So with all these interviews, initially we learned out who we need to reach out to. So first we kind of reached out to professors, and we found out they all tell us the same thing. Your problem's kind of broad, you need to narrow it down. So we tried that, and then we talked to a bunch of people, and as the weeks went on, we were talking to people from the Air Force, people from the Navy, and we found out that occasionally people gave us different feedback. So there was a lot of different feedback, and sometimes that almost caused us to pivot what we were trying to do. But we got a lot of conflicting opinions, too, from time to time. But I would say that the process of trying to interview a lot of people, it gives you mixed results, but it's good at the same time because you do get a lot of different feedback. Some of it is pretty similar, too, so that is somewhat reassuring.
And we also do like secondary resources, which are articles from online and some thesis from the Naval Postgraduate School as well, and other technologies from other universities that have encountered this problem in the past. Yeah, go ahead, sir.
You mentioned Doctors Without Borders already had a drone program. Does any of that map over to the military? In other words, can the military learn from the Doctors Without Borders experience?
I definitely think that they could, because what I read, what I actually read up on them is what they did with drones for Nepal. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with that, but that's when they utilized these drones, and they actually contracted the drones from actual drone companies, and they used them for various things. So yeah, I definitely think the Navy could learn a lot from their experience.
So, first of all, really good job, guys. You see, I learned a lot in 6 weeks. Were there any instances where the sponsor didn't necessarily agree with your hypothesis, your insights, felt you were barking up the wrong tree, and how did you deal with that?
Well, there were times when we kind of focused. Like, week one, we went to victim detection and Bluetooth honing in on victim cell phones, which is pretty specific. So initially, we had to kind of wind up and figure out, well, hold on, how does the Navy fit into this? Because it felt like, at points, we were kind of leaving and just going on our own path, trying to figure out, like, what cool technologies can we make up, and then who can we kind of pitch these to without first going down the path of looking at the Navy first and seeing what problems there were. So sometimes we did kind of go up the wrong tree and kind of get a bring back.
Oh, yeah, go ahead, too.
Did you have something to add?
Oh, no.
Okay. So, again, nice job with the work here. So, you know, looking back at your 6 weeks, what would you say is your single piece of advice you would give to somebody in the next course?
Well, certainly don't be shy to reach out, because first week we were kind of reaching out to professors and people who we knew, but it would have been nice if we had just gone over, like, I think just a few days ago we went over and saw the 3rd Fleet HQ. It took a while to get to us, but we learned a lot, and we just think that if you're going to make a product for someone, you got to make sure that you are actually talking to the right people and not just whoever you think has expertise in the field. Go with whoever has done HEAR planning cells and missions and stuff like that.
I'd like to add on. I'd also advise them to be somewhat a little bit headstrong, not to be too fickle or like to keep changing your ideas, because in the span of 6 weeks, it's hard when you're changing your ideas every week, but towards the end, when we stayed towards a single path, I think it ended up working out more.
Yes, sir.
What technique did you use to find those, the first 10 maybe professors, that might be easy, but the other 40 would be American Red Cross or Doctors Without Borders or anyone of 10 others. What technique did you use to find the right contact and somebody that would talk to you?
So most of our contacts were, I would say, sourced to us by Dr. Ray Gordner. And from there, after we conduct those initial interviews, we would ask if there's anyone he or she could refer us to that's an expert in HADR missions, or that's worked with Jones in the past, or any type of autonomous vehicles. And we did do a few cold calls to General Atomics, who unfortunately could not spare any engineers to talk to us. And we reached out to a lot of big organizations, like the Center of Excellence for Humanitarian Assistance in Honolulu, Hawaii, and we got a lot of cold shoulders as well. So we just got to roll with the punches, I guess. Yeah.
So you mentioned that the project idea kind of evolved several times over the process.
Yeah.
At what point did you really settle down on something you wanted to push forward with? That's two questions.
Well, it was an evolving process. So initially, we were given the boundary constraint of a supervisory system. And each week, we were kind of just trying to figure out what aspect of this could we even look at. So each week, the grounding role was a supervisory system of some sort. You know, you can't just go and do, like, you can't go and make your own drone. So that was the grounding aspect of it. So each week, as we honed in on more and more interviews, we were kind of getting a sense of who was saying what, and, like, are they saying it in coordination with each other? Like, is there a common opinion that's forming? At the end, we found out that crowdsourcing was kind of a big thing, and as we were looking it up, we're finding it's kind of an up-and-coming field in terms of implementing it with Navy Intel. So it was kind of just took the whole 6 weeks almost to try and figure out something, because each week was slightly different, and sometimes we were on the wrong path.
Sort of converging towards.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It took a while.
Any more questions? Great.
Yeah,
one more.
If I could.
Yes,
I guess,
Dr. Bittner, by all means.
So, very well done. You actually got at a nuance that I found it takes people a long time to understand, which is there are different folks who would be flying aircraft and working in close proximity. The military is actually very, very conservative, especially if there's manned aircraft. So as you point out, a system that allows the commander to better understand what assets and who's playing. So if the Red Cross wants to fly drones, generally speaking, the military is not going to be flying drones anywhere near. We keep them separated because we don't have good visibility and control. So I think you guys are really on to the crux of the problem. If we can't control it as the military, it's hard for us to do. And some of the other organizations, they all have different rules and ways to think about it. And as you think about how we would do that, you seem to have identified that if we can come up with a better way to communicate, whether it's using crowdsource to identify where other organizations have a standard process to share information about drone flights, we could potentially use drones more and more effectively. So I think that your ability to kind of capture that in six short weeks with no experts on the team is very impressive. I think that it's very well done. I'm kind of curious, did you think about, if you thought about information sharing or what crowdsource we're reporting, did you think about what characteristics of information or what attributes of drone information would be shared across a common interface for a commander or for folks who are flying or trying to use drones in the area?
Certainly, we kind of took examples from certain groups like UAviators, where they come in and they take drone imaging. So this imaging is used to provide a good picture, like a crisis mapping, of what has happened in the area, how much damage is in the area, who needs assistance, who needs supplies. So we kind of paralleled that with something that could be done for our system, which would be crowdsourcing, as in could be as simple as working with the Navy and pinpointing on a map where your flight plan is going to be, so that you can effectively share what you're going to do, maybe what information you're trying to collect, so that you can avoid trying to kind of collide with a confliction of interests, per se.
A main inspiration for that would probably be something like APAD, that's where you're sharing information, and I think something like that for drones would be really, really crucial for the Navy.
So that's a very, that's an interesting idea. I will tell you that we're using ATAC for drones, but nobody's talked about doing it for HADR use or making it available to other players in the HADR environment. So just that connection you just made, that portion of this conversation will be relayed, and we will probably look to explore that very rapidly. That's a very good suggestion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Fantastic. All right, let's give him another round of applause.
A couple more points of, about the class while we're getting set up here for Team Seek, Swarm, Destroy. The class was only 6 weeks long. This was a pilot class we'd run to find out, A, is this viable, and B, to be the first school to run the Hacking for Defense class after it was originally piloted. So in that way, it was very much a success, and you're seeing that right here in the student presentations right now. But I would like to point out that with that six-week class, not only were they learning about a plethora of technologies, not only were they learning about the entire Navy and how that works and how you play with the Navy, but they were also learning the lean startup process. And so they were learning about what a mission model canvas is. They were learning how to frame hypotheses and test them with a minimum viable product. And then they were learning other things as they went that maybe they didn't realize. A sense of urgency, how to make decisions with only 80% info as they went, how to reach out and cold call people. Those fundamental soft skills that I think are really going to benefit them in the future. So I hope you all were able to pull in some of that as well, and I just wanted everybody else to come in with that context. That's not something they were born with. They picked it up, and they picked it up very quickly. So.
Sorry.
Is that the,
yeah.
You can pull up the PowerPoint if you want.
Okay.
Awesome.
Okay.
So the next team we have is Team Seek, Swarm, Destroy. While they're up here as well, and we're getting set up, also wanted to add that this isn't the only opportunity they've had in the last week to speak to an incredible group of people about the work that they've done. Just this last Friday, we'd like to thank Dean Pisano for inviting the teams to present their work at his Leadership Advisory Council of Advisors.
And the Dean's Council of Advisors is the most senior group and community that advises him on planning and strategic issues related to school.
So the Dean has 20 or 30 advisors who are senior level of executives. They came in, and the students were there and able to present their work at a poster session just this last Friday. So I knew it was a success when I saw that Andy had taken a selfie with Dean Pisano and they were both smiling. We also had the opportunity to hold our class last week in the Dean's conference room. He attended with us. He was giving the students feedback as well as they went. And anybody that knows Dean Pisano knows that he gets real passionate about the details of some of these things, and he was able to give some great feedback. But not only that, that was the first time that I had ever sat in the Dean's Conference room, and I certainly didn't do so when I was in undergraduate. So I think it's a tremendous opportunity. I'm glad everybody got to do it.
I'm sorry, we're almost there.
Yeah.
Sorry, any technical issue?
You just want to know.
Yeah.
Was this open to undergrads and graduate students?
Yes, it was. Ultimately, we took the challenging part, and I know there's some people in here who are interested in setting up Hacking for Defense at other schools, and there's people coming out from Lionville. The challenging part about running a fall course that you just decided to build in the summer is recruiting students to come to the course. So my hat goes off to Jennifer. My hat goes off to Mike for really helping us dig in and do the recruiting to make this even viable. Because to bring in enough, if you look at the funnel of people coming through that are just casually interested versus people that are very interested and want to form a team and then are qualified to work on a problem like this, it was a challenging effort. So no, we did not get to the graduate students. And that's something that we're building now towards our spring class. So spring class is most likely going to be bigger. We'll probably have, I would guess, four more teams. And with that, we've been reaching out to some of the tremendous institutes here on campus at UC San Diego, such as the Institute for Contextual Robotics. Today, the Wearable Sensor Center had their conference. The Center for Visual Computing. Those are all really interesting cross-functional areas where research is being done that the military sponsors we've spoken to are very, very interested in that. Long way of circling around to saying that they all have graduate students that are working in very interesting areas that we're actively seeking to recruit into future classes. So the class is open to both undergraduate and graduate, but ultimately it's the teams apply as a team of four to a specific problem, and we put them through an interview process, and the most qualified teams make it. So great question. All right, and with that, Andy and Raina from Team Seek, Swarm, Destroy.
Hi, everyone. My name is Andy. I'm a bioinformatics major at UC San Diego. Currently, it's my fourth year, so I'm a senior. And my partner?
I'm Raina, and I am a senior undergraduate from the Department of Nanoengineering. And tonight, Andy and I are going to share with you some concepts that we have been exploring for the past 6 weeks, as well as a derived minimum viable product that we hope can be beneficial in the future. We approached this project in these past 6 weeks by conducting research throughout the academia, as well as hosting interviews with relevant stakeholders in the necessary industry and fields. At the same time, we have relativized every component of our project to a fundamental problem statement that describes both the prompt of our project as well as the overall mission statement that our minimum viable product hopes to achieve. And the problem statement that we have for you now is that due to challenging constricted waters, the Straits of Hormuz offer ample opportunity for non-state actors to functionalize autonomous swarm devices for ISR and attack missions. The U.S. Navy lacks the capability to adequately detect, characterize, and differentiate, as well as determine an appropriate response to these complex threats. So we decided to incorporate the Straits of Hormuz into our problem statement because throughout this project, we had increasingly realized how crucial this area is to the United States Navy. Located between the Persian Gulf and the Gulf of Oman, and surrounded by countries such as Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and Iran, the Straits of Hormuz form this incredibly challenging region that requires both thoughtful and sophisticated strategy and scrutiny from United States Navy assets. The overall physical parameters of the area are very challenging because with a width that can only accommodate between anywhere from 21 to 170 miles and a depth between 20 to 200 meters deep, it makes nautical traffic inherently problematic as well as congestion highly probable. This is because underwater and surface assets are only able to travel at a very limited speed, making things very tedious. At the same time, this place is extremely active due to the oil and the surrounding countries. So because of the geographical and geological challenges, we realize that this area makes it very opportune for non-state actors such as ISIS and IRGCN to functionalize and employ autonomous technologies in a swarm attack fashion. So in 2008, a Naval War Games had observed that the US Navy actually realizes that swarm attack mechanisms are very dangerous and difficult to face. This was iterated in 2002 due to some tension with Iran in the Persian Gulf. And in 2015, the non-state actors of IRGCN had this video launched, which demonstrates a practice run through that they had of over thousands of speedboat swarms and practiced these different kinds of swarm attack approaches that include both symmetrical and asymmetrical approaches that studies shown can be very, very deadly. So in constricted waters, situations like these can be incredibly problematic and very deadly. So when we were prompted with these kinds of issues, we really wanted to understand what the US Navy is currently doing, as well as the current personnel and how they each, and how which personnel approaches each kind of response to defending assets from enemy swarms. And so through that, we had to develop a customer workflow which would describe which personnel is tied to which specific action. So here we see that when swarms are deployed from a non-state actor, we are able to recognize it from some information aggregation platform. And this can be through sensing technologies or some sort of a recognition. And so that data can be analyzed from personnel that includes sonar technicians both on surface and underwater, as well as fire controlmen. And this data can also be studied and analyzed from Intel Watch Officer, as well as different kinds of technologies. So once we are able to recognize that there is a swarm or a group of assets that are approaching us, and once we realize, or once US Navy assets realize that these swarms are in fact from an enemy, they now need to make some sort of a tactical decision on how to respond to this. And the person who was in charge of that is known as a tactical action officer, or if not them, some sort of an as soon as possible decision maker. So that tactical action officer has to decide on some sort of a response, and that can include many different things, including avoiding that approaching swarm, trying to fight back, etc. And so once this is all implemented, all of the data and what we had learned and what is learned from that circumstance is fed back so that we can learn and prepare for future swarm attacks. So after mapping out this customer workflow, we decided to pinpoint some personnel that we thought were very important to study. Also people that could in fact be involved with a minimum viable product, which we will introduce later. So through this, we have developed user archetypes. And one of the archetypes that we have for you now is a sonar technician. And a sonar technician, what they basically do is they collect and interpret data that comes in that is collected in submarines as well as ships. And this data can be acoustic, sonar, radio, and their job is to see if any approaching asset is from an an enemy from the United States Navy, or maybe even a school of fish or the giant squid, we don't know. But to be a sonar technician, one must dedicate 7 to 9 weeks in boot camp, as well as an 18-week ACE school so that they can learn and understand electronics, sensor technology, and computers so that they can have a sort of fluency for the efficiency of understanding and collecting that data when the circumstance arises. Our second user archetype is a fire controlman. And what a fire controlman does is they are able to also interpret that data and see if the data collected is in fact implicative of an enemy swarm versus a friendly swarm. And they are also in charge of weapon systems. And to be a fire controlman, one has to also dedicate the same time in boot camp, as well as a longer term through A school to study mathematics, electronics, as well as computer theory so that they can understand even the digital systems that are tied with these assets. So not only are they in charge of controlling these systems, but they also have to maintain them and make sure that they work properly when they are needed. Our third user archetype is the tactical action officer, or the person who makes the actual response decision to approaching enemy swarms. And the tactical action officer is a very high role, and they are responsible for the release of weapons, and their education is significantly more rigorous. What they must do is they must graduate from the Surface Warfare Office School, and then they must hold two more positions before becoming a tactical action officer. And these include being a combat direction center watch officer, as well as an air defense weapons coordinator. They also need to be highly skilled with computers as well as sensor technologies, because they speak with the fire controlmen and the sonar technicians as well. But we also needed to understand enemies, not just our own assets and our own personnel. So in this slide, we wanted to understand how would a non-state actor employ an enemy swarm. And so what we have here is ISIS is an example of non-state actors. And what they do is to have some sort of a technology that they think can be harmful. They find technologies that are commercial off the shelf, also known as COTS, or any kind of a technology that can be easily accessible but inherently dangerous. Once they are able to build or buy these devices, they have to deploy them in some certain way. And there are many different ways that that can happen. It can be through land, it can be off of a plane through air, it can be on the surface, or even underwater. And so once these devices are deployed as a swarm, they have to find the target that they want to execute their mission for. And so they can track their target in many different ways. One thing about the swarm mechanism in general is that it defines a multitude of beings, of menial beings, that have the same task. And so there are many different ways that swarms can communicate and execute that designated task. And so these swarms, when they can track their target, they can either communicate amongst each other or with an external controller in some base. So once they are able to finally track the target to execute their mission, they can finally do that. But the missions vary. There are many different ways that a non-state actor can functionalize devices to have some sort of a swarm tactical effect. And these can include ISR, so sometimes they can employ devices that can gather information and be spies. They can sometimes do attacks or plant bombs in mines for future encounters. And they can also be suicide bombings and distractions. So once these missions are executed and damage is or may not be done, all of this is fed back to them so that they can understand and plan and study how to implement their next attack or swarm mission. So now we have to study how does the U.S. Navy defend against swarms, not just through personnel, but what are their approaches? So in the same way, they would detect the deployment of these swarms from non-state actors through many different sensing platforms. What we have learned through interviewing with our stakeholders is that United States Navy assets actually have access to many incredibly high-powered, state-of-the-art technologies. And these sensing technologies can be on acoustic, visual, optical, subtropic force, so energy conversion, possibly solar, passive versus active, magnetic fields. So these then, once these devices are sensed and the deployment is detected, they have to be characterized. So we need to make sure, are these swarms, is it an actual enemy swarm? Or is it a school of small fish just coming towards us? Or maybe it's a swarm of our own, we may not even be sure. So we need to be able to differentiate and identify that first. Once that happens, there must be some sort of a suggestion or a response. So how do we respond to these approaching swarms? And that is something that we will go into more depth later in this presentation. But once that decision is made, the response is executed. And what we've realized is that there are many different ways that you can interrupt or prevent a swarm from actually executing its mission. And this can include collecting data. It just could be very simple. So maybe we had an ISR swarm and they just wanted to get information. So one way that we can respond is to find out what information did they gather, or what kind of swarms were these? How did they interact? And how can we plan for that in the future? Another response is just to simply avoid them. Maybe they're not so much of a dangerous threat that if we just try to steer away from them, then things would be safer. Or we can jam the communication between these devices. So that can mean interrupting the communication between one device and the other, or interrupting the communication between the swarm and the external controller. Or we can counterattack or have some sort of a confusion or decoy mechanism. So we can send dummy swarms of our own to convince them to go somewhere else and distract them from actually implementing their real task.
Okay, so the system that we are proposing solves the US Navy's problem of identifying and characterizing a growing library of swarm threats and the vulnerabilities. So here we can see that we've characterized a swarm, what a swarm might be, UUVs, USVs, and UAVs. And an example of this I can give you is that we could take any example of a swarm system and define it using these traits, like near communication, motion bandwidth, 20 elements underwater, electricity propellers, propulsion, each carrying a fused explosive. So each element carrying a fused explosive. Now, here we have our mission model canvas, and sonar operators and a controller on board the ship, which the value proposition that we've offered this sonar tech is that fused sensor data display and organize data to indicate swarm threats and detect other threats from which the swarms are drawing attention. For the fire controlmen, we've proposed that a single system monitor, sensor fusion, and recommended reaction based on type of swarm threat. For the tactical action officer, we've basically come up with the proposition as classification of a swarm versus non-swarm and faster threat classification. For our partners, you know, we would like to we've done a lot of work with we would like to continue doing work with Scripps, UCSD Jacobs School of Engineering, Defense Contractors, SPAWAR, Naval Postgraduate School, Office of Naval Research. And for deployment, we want to test this out at the JTFX, and also we want to demonstrate and test at the Naval RIMPAC, and also
probably, you know, when they appeal to early adopters such as SOCOM. For our mission achievement, we have we were able to increase the probability of detecting swarms, and also we were able to see that we can probably protect more lives, vessels, infrastructures from swarm attacks. So for our hypothesis and MVP, we've looked into user interface, and here we can see for our hypothesis is that swarms can be classified using fused data sources. Different swarm types have different vulnerabilities, and tactical reactions to swarms will be faster and more effective if their characteristics of, are displayed to U.S. Navy warfighters. Here we have a user interface that we've created basically of how we're going to approach this idea. Now, the dots in the green are basically the U.S. Navy infrastructures, and then the dots in the red are the possible threats around it. And using this information, this is our goal plan of what we want to continue doing. So for our journey, when we were first handed this project and this problem by the Navy, we understood it. We took it to a point where we're like, okay, they want us to detect and probably disable swarms. All right, great. But as we went further into the next week, we found out that things were getting very classified. So we continued to run through this problem with classification. Everything was so classified with underwater autonomous vehicles that we weren't able to find too much information on. So then we're like, hey, let's wait. So now let's try to probably characterize swarm vulnerabilities. Maybe this is the route that we should take in helping out the Navy. Maybe this is something that's missing out that we're not thinking of. So when we started looking into that, then we saw this progress increasing as we spoke with more of our stakeholders and as we spoke with our mentors. We saw that this solution or this information is the key to what we need to do. And midterms hit hard. It was a midterms week, and we had a slight decline, but it wasn't something that we couldn't get over. We got back into work, and we started doing more work, and now we're here at the sixth week. We've proposed a system or a solution to the Navy that is really effective and is very viable. So it's something that the Navy can definitely use to continue on with this. Now, I just want to thank you, all of our sponsors, our mentors, and of course, everyone that has helped us to contributing our and boosting our project and our idea, and of course all of the technology experts out there as well. We have Spaywar, Bob Higginson was one of the guys from there, and of course our mentors and sponsors, Saad Ansari and Dr. Breutner, as well as our instructors, Travis DeMeester and Ellen Chang, and of course Mike as well, and Jennifer, and So going forward, continuing research and academic collaboration, learn more about the Navy, maybe get some tours. We were given a tour of a submarine at the Navy, but the only thing was everything was really classified, so we needed a lot of clearances, and we had to actually leave our phone in the car as well, so we couldn't take any pictures around there. But what I did was the submarine that we got the tour of, I went on Google and I found it, and it was a San Francisco class, Los Angeles, and 777. So that was the submarine that we had the tour. It was really nice, and just getting the tour around the submarine, I saw the different types of technology that were available to the operators, and I saw where the sonar techs sat, and I saw where the fire controlmen sat, and then I also saw where the commanders were sitting and the captains were as well. So this field experience, this experience was a great boost to us, because now we can understand how everything works in the actual field. How are they using the system? What are they focused on during a situation like this, during a threat that is approaching them very quickly? So this is a great way for us to go at it. And then also we've had many interviews. We've had about 30 to 35 interviews with plenty of stakeholders, and the way we got a hold of them was just through in the beginning, what we did was we had a few stakeholders sent to us, well, connected to us with through our professors, our instructors, sorry, and then our other stakeholders. But as we progressed on, we learned that how the communication does matter. And in the end, what we did was we created a template of questions for our stakeholders. And at the end of the template, what we would do is we would ask them, like, hey, do you have any other contact that can help us in boosting our project? Do you have any other information that you can give to us? Or do you even have any articles to share with us that can help us with this idea that we're at? And that's how we were able to progress through our project as well. And we're also looking for funding. So if you have some change, please send it my way. I'll keep a box here. But yeah, that's something that we're really looking into, because I feel like our idea that we have going here is it's very viable, and it will help out the Navy in a lot in the long run. And yeah, so once again, thank you for being here, and thank you for being a great audience.
It's classified. But so what we have learned from our interviews is that they have all kinds of different sensing technologies. But one thing that we're really thinking about approaching for our minimum viable product is having different kinds of sensing. So not just depending on acoustic sensing, but possibly overlapping that with visual sensing. So maybe sometime we can have an air drone that has, it's able to understand the bird's eye view traffic of the straits and be able to interpret where exactly everything is. And that can be coupled with possibly acoustic sensing on the surface or in the submarine, and maybe magnetic sensing. It's still something that we're looking into, though.
Yeah, as you said, a lot of this information was classified. So, but I think like Raina covered it mostly. The common ones that we've heard through our interviews were acoustic, magnetic. Those are the very common ones that they use currently right now. But because UUV is still such a new, new technology that's in the next 5 years that is going to be there to be a threat as well, it's still developing. So, right, yeah, that's where we were.
On the logistics side of things, what was it like splitting up interviews? I know we have pretty ambitious interview goals, just the two of you. Just about quite working.
Going through this project, it was a tough field. It was a tough thing to take upon. But it's, I guess, like we developed this interest in this idea, in this project, that we were just really motivated by it. And like I said, these tours really mattered, because when I went on this tour, right, our tour guide, his name is Walker Washburn. He was a lieutenant with them, and he was actually a dolphin seal as well. And now this guy was asking, like, have you guys ever been on a tour before? Have you ever been on a submarine? I was like, do the Disneyland, the one, the Finding Nemo count? He's like, no, that one doesn't count. I was like, all right, then no, I haven't been on one. So, just getting out there in the field, it was really motivating. It was just really inspiring, because now I know what I'm doing, and I know who I'm doing it for, and what it's going to help, what part of the infrastructure is going to help. So having that in mind, and it was really inspiring, yeah.
We definitely learned at that same time how to be sensitive to approach people with these kinds of questions, because in the very beginning of this project, we had reached out to stakeholders through email, describing our project and our motivations. And it was kind of like saying, hey, tell us every secret that you know. Like, maybe just in, like, we might keep it a secret, right? So we had to learn how to articulate what we wanted to learn from these stakeholders in a way that we can get as much information from them as possible, but also respect the whole ethics behind the confidentiality in the field.
Yes, sir.
This triggers a lot of thoughts, but the first one is, We had a similar problem 40 years ago, or at least, where we went from having to defend against aircraft from, say, a surface ship, to having to defend against incoming missiles from surface to surface, or possibly from a submarine. And one of the solutions that you probably tripped over when you were doing this was the phalanx gun, which may be mainly a gun that will put out enough rounds of ammunition that when that incoming is so close, your probability of having hit is very high. Now, the reason I'm bringing that up is you're on a really, really interesting project. And part of the information is in the public domain right now. You can look up Robotics One technology, find out all kinds of things. The same thing that ISIS can do or any of these other non-state actors. So that part of your research is the easy part, in that it's not classified. The hard part, I think, is going to be the defense mechanism and possibly some of the detection parts. So
yes.
I'd say keep on this because it's a really hot area.
Thank you. And you know, this is what we started off with, was like what the Navy proposed to us was like, hey, detect swarm UUV technology, that's what, underwater swarms. And we're like, all right, we can do that. So we started reading up, we started doing our work, and it just led to that point where it was like, you know, there's a lot of offensive measures, but there were very little defensive measures. So then what we landed on was let's propose a system that identifies these vulnerabilities the swarms have, and maybe we can work on this, and this might be a tool or a way to help the Navy, not tell what the Navy what to do, but maybe help them identify and characterize these different types of swarms. Because remember, these are, we have, there's many, many swarm technologies. There's a plethora level library of swarm technologies out there. And maybe just identifying what the vulnerabilities are, that can help fasten or make the process of taking a right action go a lot faster. So that's why we landed on this system, and we're like, hey, maybe this can work.
Are you going to continue this project? I mean, you had 6 weeks. Do you have another 6 weeks, or what's the goal?
So that's something that I was talking to our instructor. Hey, Travis, after the sixth week, like after our final presentation, what do you want us to do? Like, I'm really really stoked about this project and really interested in continuing it. And he's like, yeah, we have this we have this huge spring course coming up, and it's going to be a lot longer than the 6 weeks that we gave you guys, because this was, this was just to test the waters and see how things were going, or what was going to happen, right? So this is something that we will continue. So if you have some change, please spare. But yeah, this is something that we will definitely continue, and we will probably look into getting more partners as well. So just throwing that out there.
This is part of the evolution of what we want to do with this program, trying to figure out what to do next. And so, we're learning as much as they're learning, because we're trying to figure out how to execute this thing and get the maximum benefit for everybody. And so right now the answer is we're very flexible on this issue.
Yeah, there's a lot of learning.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so again, congratulations.
Thank you.
For the presentation. So I can tell you, tomorrow you're going to go through what's called customer discovery withdrawals. You're going to just want to interview people for no reason. So you have to grapple with your trough of despair. You know, you're just going down, everything's classified, you're not
yeah.
going anywhere. Can you guys share with us what insight, what caused you guys to pivot and finally get something that got you moving in the right direction?
I think focusing on non-state actors was what really helped us to have a better idea of what technologies we wanted to take a look at, things that could possibly be a little more understandable and accessible. So I think that in itself was a huge pivot point for us, as well as focusing on the Straits of Hormuz, that general area.
Yes. So up until the third week, we did not have a specific location to focus on. Yeah, we went through many stakeholders, but the question we always left out by accident was, what areas will this occur in? Like, will it occur in the middle of the ocean? Where would it occur in? So then Bob Higginson was the first guy to tell us, hey, you guys should focus on something near the port, because that's where this activity is usually. And we're like, okay, near the port, that's a great start. Now, then the next question was, okay,
what kind of pork, where specifically, what region of the world or what part of the world. So then we started getting into the Strait of Hormuz and how dense that area is and how big of a traffic goes through that area. And as one of our pictures that we put up there, and you guys can actually see the map of that area and how populated it is and how bad the traffic really is in that area. So that's what, when we pinpointed our location, then we were like, okay, we have our location, this is where all the non-state actors are active right now as we speak as well. And there are some other areas in the world as well, but this is the main area right now. So after that, we were able to figure out, and it was just climbing the stairs, climbing steps after that, and yeah, that's where we got.
Yeah, I think I was just going to throw out, it might be interesting to look at your taxonomy for categorizing the different types of UUVs through what the operator's response is going to be. So they're going to use the acronym F2T2EA, which is find. So what sensors are you going to use to find this? Fix, meaning how are you going to locate them? How are you going to track them? How are you going to target them? Then how are you going to engage them? And based off of each one of those, the categorizations you have, you may have a different response in terms of, what sensor is going to be able to detect that? How are you going to fix it? How are you going to track it? How are you going to engage it? And whether that's kinetically or non-kinetically.
Yeah.
And then the other piece I would add to it is the geography is very important too, because some of those sensors in the area you're looking at will not be particularly effective. So you'll have to also kind of wrestle with that, even though maybe this sensor in a quieter column of water would be very effective. In this particular area, it's not going to be effective. And so that's just another interesting take you might look into.
Okay.
Absolutely.
No, definitely, yeah, we'll definitely look into that. You have one, right?
Yeah.
All right, your turn.
Now, how did this experience change any perceptions that you had going into it about either military organizations or military personnel that were serving? Was there anything that was really surprising to you after seeing the day in the life out there, how to kind of shape your overall view of things?
Okay, so the question was, is there anything out there surprising to us about shaped our
about the military organizations and the service members themselves?
I see. So about the military organizations, service members.
Respect.
Yeah.
Most certainly.
The organization between the Navy and the military, it's phenomenal. When I went on the tour to the submarine, I saw everything was organized. I saw that everything was in line and everyone had their cues of what to do and what not to do. And even in the submarine, everything was just aligned. Each person knew where their bed was, to the point where they knew where their beds were also. So that was one big thing that I picked up on, and that's why I wanted to. Then I wanted to propose a system where, let's propose an organized system where we can help them continue this organization until, even with newer technologies, this huge library of technology that's advancing so every day, right? It's crazy. So that's what I really liked about it. You have one.
Yeah, it's interesting you're focusing on submarines. I'm picturing that Straits of Hormuz. The biggest problem is you've got tankers, you've got Navy ships, surface ships, and so forth. So one of the challenges would be, okay, let's say you have some response that says you can open fire with X, whatever that weapon is. It's like shooting in a theater when there's a gunman someplace. Who's the enemy, and who are you going to do collateral damage to?
Right.
Did that happen? Did you get into that or not yet?
We actually haven't gotten into that, but we did look into when I was just speaking as a submarine as a personal experience that I had on a tour, but our system is mainly for Navy infrastructure, so it could be submarines, ships, and other infrastructures included. But yeah, but we did not kind of look into what you mentioned earlier. No.
You're not gonna engage with it.
we don't have that for the underwater.
So you could use an ASRock.
There's other UUVs out there.
A short range ASRock. I mean, a mortar. Just a marine mortar right now.
You could use a marine mortar.
Yeah.
But if you can target it, you know, I mean, how are you going to get the sensor fusion to the mortar system?
What about just
you and I could talk about that
because
they didn't go there.
one last question.
Just to clarify, specifications of this mission you're looking at, this is to counter swarms of small unmanned systems, probably close range within a kilometer.
So, yes, so this is something that you would buy off, like, your COTS, so cheap commercial off the shelf technology that some non state actors can get their hands on. And now for deployment, a lot of them would use there's different techniques, there's different types of technology out there, so there's different techniques that each person would use. Some of the techs that we walked into was they would use a floating base on the surface of the water, right, and then they would have swarms under. So that was one way of keeping in touch with the swarms under, right? That's how they would say, hey, you know, I'm the ship, and now you just follow me, and I'll just guide you, basically. Now, another swarm UUV that we ran into was called Kokoro. What that did was a pre-programmed type of tech, UUV, and how that worked was the way they communicated was through a B-Clust algorithm. And basically, it was actually inspired by the bee colonies and how they use senses to gather each other. So that's how this device worked as well. But yeah, there are many technologies, and there's an infinite library of them. All right.
Wonderful job, guys. Wonderful job.
Hi, can I add a comment or two?
Oh.
Please do.
Yeah,
do.
Go ahead. Sorry, we forgot about you.
So I didn't want to ask questions. I couldn't see how big the audience was, and it sounds like they got most of ours. First, I'd be happy to support you following up and visiting one of our interagency field experiments. Will be going on in August in San Diego, and the next one is in February. If the two of you would like to come out, I'm sure we can cover travel costs to bring a couple folks up, and you could present your work and talk with some of our folks. As some folks have pointed out, the taxonomy and the way you've broken down the threat I find very interesting. We have a PhD student looking at developing a taxonomy that would be useful for developing swarm tactics, and I'd be interested in a discussion between you and her on how those two things might blend together. That would be very interesting to me.
Yeah, of course, Dr. Benner, you know, like you said, we're looking for this type of stuff, and
it would be a privilege, absolutely.
Exactly. You're really excited.
So we'll work at that as an after-class event, I guess, so we can talk through how to do that. As someone who's driven, it sounded like one or two of the other folks there, driven a warship through the Gulf with the threats that are related to it. The Iranian National Guard coastal folks there, I'm not sure if I consider them non-state actors, but those swarms are certainly a threat. I think you really touched on some good thinking there that can help us develop a methodology that then we can optimize the sensors we have. As someone else mentioned, when you get into those kind of confined straits, the targets and the way we normally would employ those systems is very difficult to do. So we kind of need a better way to think about it faster. One of the things that's hard about the swarms is the time it takes to target each individual element when there's a lot of them coming. And underwater is especially challenging in that area.
Yes.
So I think you guys are right in the sweet spot, and I would be happy to kind of work with you either in a follow-on class or whatever the appropriate way is to kind of help you move that idea forward. And I'll certainly share, actually both teams' presentations will be shared with a variety of folks, both at the Naval Postgraduate School and with some of the partners we're working with. So very well done. Thank you.
Of course.
Thank you.
All right. And I also want to mention that this our information here for both teams was submitted into the war game. So it was kind of played against the blue team and red team in a way as well. So like, what if blue team does this and the red team, what do you have to do? So yeah, I just want to throw that out there as well. So yeah, thank you guys.
All right, at this point, I'd like to just acknowledge a few people who have been instrumental. Deneen Hagen, thanks, Deneen. We came to her late in the summer and said, hey, we have this great idea called Hagen for Defense. Can we make it happen now? And she bent over backwards to help us make that happen. Jennifer Interaldi is doing her thing, always making things happen, working tirelessly day and night. So we truly appreciate that. Our mentors who mentioned, Justin Wells and Dan Hendrickson, he's worth another thank you to them. And Bob Higginson, Bob came recommended to me by Sean, who's sitting next to him, who joined us tonight, and was a wonderful asset to the class, so appreciate that. Darren Helford here is here with us tonight. Please introduce yourselves to him if you haven't at some point. He came, flew down from the Bay Area to check this out. He's leading up the Hagen for Defense initiative up there, and so that's he's been a big asset, and we've worked constantly with him. So with that, we are recruiting mentors moving forward. We're recruiting new military problem statements going forward. And so we're actively looking within the San Diego area to do that. That's the wonderful advantage we have going here, in addition to the beautiful community that we live in, is that it has such a strong military community, has such a strong academic community. And so please reach out with either interest or follow-up, just as we will do the same with any of the students who have been involved, to continue to make connections for them that will help them move forward with their ideas and projects. So. Ellen, did you have anything to add there?
No, the only thing I have to add is I appreciate everyone coming and sharing this experience with us. It's been successful, and we hope the community continues to grow.
Absolutely. Thanks, everybody, for coming by. Appreciate it.
Thank you.